It's an honor to be here, and to be asked me to do the keynote speak is real special, because this is a group of individuals in a town and a medical community they have a lot of respect for. So to be asked to speak at this, I gave it a lot of thought, and I thought, well, what am I going to speak to and present to this kind of group? And I thought, I'd just kind of go with what I believe and what's important for me. And what's important for me really is passion for what I do for sports medicine-wise, and I think that's important. My presentation today is going to be defining your passion and purpose for sports medicine. And when you look at that, we look at passion. Passion's a fire. Passion's what gets us out of bed every morning. And really, where's your heart and what are you putting into it? I want to focus a little more on the purpose. And when you look at purpose, at least the way I look at it, it's the why. And with a 3.5-year-old son at home, I get a lot of why questions. And I think everyone who has little ones, that why question is important. And I think if you look at them, I'm a big fan of asking the right kind of questions, whether it be with our patients or with ourselves. And we look at this, again, defining our passion and our purpose. That why, when you look at whys and you ask enough questions of the whys and you dig deep enough with why questions, what does it give you? It gives you your beliefs. And we look at what we do every day, your beliefs are really what's going to drive that train. And if you ask enough questions, perfect example, you say, I do with myself, you know, why am I an athletic trainer, physical therapist? Well, because I love being around sports. Why do I love being around sports? Well, it's a challenging, fun environment. Why is it challenging and fun? Well, you're testing yourself, and you're testing yourself and your body and your mind. Well, why is testing your body and your mind important? Because ultimately, you want to stay ahead of the curve, and you want to be able to do more and get the most out of yourself. So if you ask those kind of questions, my belief is the fact that I have to challenge myself if I feel like I'm going to get the most out of myself. And I think I asked a question. In the athletic training room, I like to ask a lot of questions unrelated to football. And one of the questions I ask the guys is, what would be the worst job you could ever have? And for me, it would be a security guard, or someone that I just kind of sat there and I didn't move. I have to be moving, and I think that's real important. So when you look at the why and asking those kind of questions and getting to your beliefs, I think is something that's important for everyone in this room, myself included, is to ask that question of why more times than not, to get to those beliefs. Because as those beliefs change, if you look at the path of where we are now and where we were 5 years ago, is there anybody in the room that had a straight line? Exactly. It's a curved path. A lot's changing. A lot's going to come to our plate. A lot's going to come in our lives that's going to influence what we do. But it's always going to go back to that why. And I think the thing I think it's important to ask everyone in this room is, what is your why? And defining that why is important. Interesting, if you look at the how, asking how questions, what does that give you? It gives you your strategies. You want to find out someone, how the grandmother makes that great cake, ask her how questions. How do you do this? How do you do that? You want a strategy of... I asked Blaine Gabbert this the other day, you know, how do you do this and how do you read it? What are you looking at the defense? When you throw the ball, are you looking at the wide receiver or are you following the path of your ball? And I love getting to that, but if you want someone's strategies, ask how questions. But the trick today is looking at the why. And again, the definition of this presentation today is defining your passion and your purpose for sports medicine. Look at that last equation, sports medicine. Does anybody have a clear definition of what sports medicine is? It's across the board. I asked one of my interns to do that, pull some things up and look what's there. It's all across the board. So here we are working in a profession that we're specialists, everybody in this room, of a profession that we can't truly define. I think that's cool because we can redefine it. We can do a lot. We can change that. Your definition of sports medicine is different than yours. So sports medicine is what we make it and what we apply to our athletes and what we do for ourselves. So we get the cool opportunity to be involved with a career that we can define. Something I use in helping me define my why is what I call my happy stones. What's the difference between a stone and a rock? A rock is just something. A stone is something special. If you think of, ooh, this is different. What I call happy stones, and I always use this, I have certain happy stones, and I think it's a smart way to find ways. What makes you smile? What I call a happy stone is something that you have in your pocket or in your mind, in your heart, that makes you smile, that has nothing to do with your profession, and nothing to do with what helps you make a living or put money in your pocket. So what's your happy stone? I have three happy stones. One is my family. My family smiles and laughs. I got a 1-year-old at home and a 3.5-year-old and a beautiful wife. And just seeing them smile and hearing them laugh in the other room or in the morning, for me, that's a happy stone. That makes me smile, makes me feel good. One of my other happy stones is just running in the woods. That daydream of running in the woods, for me, is something that puts a smile on my face, makes me feel good during those long 20-hour days during training camp. And the other thing, one of my happy stones, is just challenges for sports. I do a lot of extreme sports. I've done 6 Ironman triathlon. I've run with the Bulls in Pamplona. I've cage dive with great white sharks in South Africa, bungee jumped in New Zealand. I do a lot of extreme, challenging sports. And for me, those challenges, again, what's one of my beliefs? Is challenging my body and my mind is real important. So those are my three happy stones, and I welcome you to think about what are your happy stones and what's your why. And don't be afraid to share your why. And let me show of hands here. How many people have a written mission statement? There we go. Not a lot. And I ask you to do that. Again, because what are the things I want everybody to walk out of this room to really feel, to be very honest with you? And I thought about this, and I have a focus word that I always use before a presentation, is to be motivated. And to be motivated to do something and having that mission statement to evaluate yourself is real important. And my mission statement is to enhance the health of others while challenging myself as an athlete. And for the longest time, it was just enhance the health of others. But I thought, I love this sports thing. I love to do a lot of different things. So that's just as important as what I'm doing. And by learning from athletes at an elite level and finding what they do, what works, what doesn't work, I'd rather learn my mistakes on them than on myself. It's cheaper. It's less painful. But having those things and sharing that and having that mission statement and writing it down and continue to evaluate is a great way to do it. Again, what are we trying to do here? We're trying to find your why. First of all, when you look at that, as far as molding, what really created my why and what I do is a couple things. Is the fact that I love sports now and as a little kid. Sports was it. I grew up playing sports. I have a twin brother. So we were fighting and competing, and just sports was just as normal as breathing for me as a kid, and still is. The other thing is I had a lot of great coaches and a lot of leaders. Positions I've had and blessings I've had in my life haven't because I've been the best athletic trainer or the best person or best whatever. It's that I've been very fortunate. A lot of people in my life have done a lot to help me. And I'm basically a summation of a lot of people willing to help me. And I think it's important. People in this room, I see a lot of people nodding their head, because that's why we like helping people that we do, because a lot of people have helped all of us get to where we need to be. And I think an important part of what we do with our profession in sports medicine is giving back to others and helping others, because those others and people in our lives have really helped us. And that's been a real big part of me and really helped me get defining my why. Another part is a lady named Miss Garofalo in 10th grade. For the longest time, I would never, when the teachers would come in and say, who's going to college? I'd raise my hand and say, I'm not going to go to college, because I couldn't find anything that really floated my boat. If I wasn't going to make it as an NFL football player, I didn't know what I was going to be. But I thought nothing was really clicked. Miss Garofalo used to bring me in and give me these little pop quizzes and whatnot. And I remember the day in 10th grade, she told me about this profession of athletic training, and it clicked just like that. And I remember running home that day and telling my parents, I'm going to go to college to be an athletic trainer and work in the NFL. It was as clear as looking at that wall right now. And I was very fortunate, because I found something that really clicked and I loved it. And she did something smart. She went to my track coach and she went to my football coach and told them. So now they started talking to me and telling me about different stuff. How does a muscle work? How does this work? I was a pole vaulter and a runner and played football. Well, how does your arm work and your shoulder joint work? They started feeding me information about the human body and about athletic trainers they work with in college. And it was a great fuel source to kind of get me going to redefine what I needed to do. Another big part of the thing that we look at our lives, like I said, it's not a straight path. And a lot of things in our lives aren't a smooth road. In January of 84, I was running track in college. And I was out drinking with my buddies and having a good time. And one thing led to another. And pop, I dislocated and fractured my ankle. Laying in a parking lot at 2 o'clock in the morning with my ankle up on my gluteus maximus. But it changed my life, and it made a big difference. I couldn't run track that year. It made me realize how important athletics were. I went to a conference, the head athletic trainer for the New York Giants. At that conference, I had a cast up to my thigh, gave me a job as an intern for the New York Giants, and everything really clicked. So bad things can happen in your lives. Roll with the punches, because it can be a real great thing. And that thing really made a big difference for me. So my why has come from a lot of different ways, and I feel very, very fortunate because of that. You know, how do you find your why? Let me ask a question. What's the only known food that doesn't expire? No. Honey, exactly. Does it go bad? And I always use that analogy for myself and people around me, especially older people, is why is suddenly the term athlete have an expiration date? It shouldn't. How many people in here are participating in the same sports they did in high school? Great. Not a lot. But I ask the question of why. Why do you, because we get a full-time job, we get a mortgage, we get kids, all the things we need to do, why do we have to take our athlete label and put it aside? Because that's a big part of what we do. I guarantee you, we go around this room, we look at people that got into the sports and the professions that you're doing now. A lot of them came from sports. You got hurt in sports, you work with someone, and this is pretty cool. Look what this guy's doing, or that guy's doing, or that girl's doing. So a lot of things we need to do. Being an athlete does not expire. And I see a lot of people smiling in here, probably because you're reflecting on the sports that you do. And there's sports that you did. And getting back to that, uncovering what you want to do as an athlete, getting back to it, I think, is very important. As far as defining your why itself, I ran a mud run locally this March, and they had, in the competitive division, I won it. And I told my wife, I went home, and I said, this may be the last big race I'll ever win. At 49 years old, and I'm thinking, I'm going to make the most. We went out to dinner, had a good time for 24 hours, got excited about it, and then pushed it aside. But getting excited about it and patting yourself on the back about good accomplishments. You drop 5 pounds, you run a 5K road race, you go out and play with your kids, you hit a jump shot from the top of the key like you haven't done in 10 years. Whatever it is, enjoy yourself. Jump up and down. Do the things you need to do to give yourself that credit. Positive reinforcement is very, very important. And the way I look at it, there's two ways to reinforce yourself and motivate yourself. Pleasure or pain. You can pat yourself on the back. You can hang a carrot out there, get all excited about, you know, the big race or fit into those old jeans or whatever it is. Or pain, you can kick yourself in the ass. And really, in reality, if you look at what motivates us, it's usually a combination of the two. So I think it's important to kind of look at that, give yourself credit where due, be a little tough on yourself when you really have to, but reviving that again, getting motivated and finding your why is very important. Another thing to do is to ask more why questions, like we talked about that, and really dig deep on it. Because the thing is, most of us make thought processes on our whys, but most people make our decisions on our emotions. And you have to separate those two. What's really, really important to you? You get caught up in an emotion of this, that, you make a decision, that's different. But you got to realize that if you're getting to the real reason why you're doing stuff, it's more the why than it is just the emotions. And also a neat thing to do, and a dangerous thing at the same time, is ask some of your dearest, closest friends if they were to write down 3 words to define you. What would those 3 words be? You kind of hope they're these 3 words, but they might be these kind of 3 words. But it's a neat way to find out, because they're seeing you from the outside in, and they know you from the inside out. So finding is a good way to kind of define what's there. What example am I setting compared to what am I thinking of myself? And I think if you look at that and get that feedback from them, and again, sharing that is a great way to again, to find your why. Okay. And next is what are we doing in sports medicine? What's really there? And let me ask another question is, when you're in a plane and you're flying with someone real dependent, real young or real old, and suddenly those oxygen masks drop, what do you need to do? What's your first job? Put it on yourself, exactly. So my question is, why aren't you doing that with your health in reference to your patients? You worry about them, you're getting them better, you're getting them back in the game, all these different things, and now you're not taking care of yourself. Like I always say, you can't properly take care of others if you're not properly taking care of yourself. And that's real important. Cholesterol, your overall health, the health of your attitude, your mindset, all those things are very, very important. Most of us in this room are probably overworked, too many hours, sleep deprived. That kind of comes with the landscape. So it's real important that we're taking care of ourselves. Again, reviving that whole process of what we're doing. Again, we need to kind of take care of ourselves with what's there. And again, this is a little bit of a wake-up call, in my opinion, say, hey, what do I need to do? We have all the answers. Because think about it, we're not some computer geek sitting at a terminal in a cubicle somewhere. We're sports medicine specialists. We're the best of the best, work with athletes in a sports medicine field. So we have those answers. If not, we have someone close to it that can give us those answers, true? So we're just applying what we're doing for other people. And it seems very central and very elementary, but in a lot of ways, I think it's very, very important. Because burnout in this profession, and I've seen the studies, the burnout in this profession, whether it be athletic trainers, physical therapists, or physicians, is pretty high. And I think taking care of ourselves can do a lot of good, because if we make one person better, we know this with patients day in and day out, we make that one person better, they suddenly became what? A better husband or better wife, a better coworker, a better brother, better sister, a better mom, a better coworker, all these different things. So one person has a ripple effect that could easily impact 50 people. Why not yourself? If you make yourself better, if you make yourself healthy, if you make yourself think better, better about yourselves and doing the right things and the right kind of habits, voila, you're a lot better, fill in the blank. Okay? But I also understand, too, I get it. A lot of people in this room have a business. And you can't say, okay, I'm going to take a two-hour lunch break and, you know, run through the daisies in the meadow somewhere. You have a business you have to run. But I can tell you this, the fact that at every level, it doesn't matter if it's at a college level, it's an office, it's in an NFL, it's in a collegiate setting. If you have a more compassionate why, you're going to have a better business. You're going to be better to work with. Your patients are going to see the difference. And there's nothing wrong with a compassionate why. And I think that's a lot of reasons why we're in this room, because we're compassionate. We care about people we work with. And stoking up that compassionate why can go a long way. As far as what we do, if you think about it, our business is to help athletes do their job, help patients do their job. So if we're doing the job, we're decreasing their pain, we're improving their range of motion, we allow them to play with their kids, all the things we need to do, that's part of what we do. Are we content in that role? I think most of us are. We might want to tweak what we need to do, but we're content with what's there. But I also ask this question, as a statement, if you get to be 50 years old, statistically proven, and you haven't had one of the big three, coronary artery disease, a stroke, or cancer. So again, you haven't had one of those three and you're 50 years old. As a male, you'll live to be 88 years old. As a female, a little better. You're going to be average life expectancy is about 92. So if you're sitting there in your late 50s, you say, hey, I'm, you know, not too far away from retirement, all the things I could do, you still have, by statistically speaking, over 40 years to live. There's a lot of living there. And this body you have, you're going to have to take care of it now, is going to make a big difference later on. So there's a lot of living to do, and what we need to do, and applying what we know day in and day out to ourselves goes a long, long way. And it makes that, what are we looking at here? Quality of life. And that quality of life is going to be a lot better as well. And I think it's important, too, if we look at what our athletes want from us. Put yourself patient. Let's say you're a patient, you're laying on the table. Who would you want working on you? You'd want someone who's kinder, healthier, and they want to be safe. So all those things you do from a mindset and from a body perspective really kind of accomplishes those three things. And I think that's important if you're taking it from the patient's perspective, looking back at you and what we do day in and day out. In closing, I have to say that I love my profession, and I'm sure a lot of you do as well. I'm very fortunate what we need to do. If you think about it, we get paid to take care of athletes. We get paid to take care of our patients to make them feel better. Think of it, if the individuals in this room, if they were out and their patients all gathered together, which is thousands of them, maybe tens of thousands of people in this room we've impacted, and they're out there singing our praises, that's huge. And that's one of the things that we do what we do so we can make them go out and do what they need to do. And we get paid to do that. I think that's pretty cool. And I think the fact of being content and being compassionate what we need to do and having that fire also goes a long way. Because I know for me, the fuel for my purpose comes in what I do day in and day out. And I guess the question I ask for everybody, as I ask a lot of our patients, is what's your fuel? Is your fuel high-octane petrol, or is it McDonald's? Something has to add that fire with what we need to do. And I think if we look at it and we evaluate there, and we find our own why, I think the passion's easy. You guys took a beautiful Saturday morning to come out here to spend time to get yourself better and to get educated. So that passion is not in question. And I think when we find that why and that purpose of what we need to do, I think that only makes it that much easier. How would you define your purpose and your passion for sports medicine? In summary, finding your happy stones. Call them whatever you want. But finding what those are, those things you can always rely on, you can reflect back on, and having those things, that goes a long way of keeping your why in focus. Dusting yourself off, like I said, as an athlete. Do what you need to do. And you don't have to be climbing mountains. You don't have to swim in the English Channel. Get out there and move. Our body, our human body, is made to move, and doing that and kind of rekindling that joy of what you need to do as a kid and having fun can go a long, long way. Like I said, fueling your passion with the right kind of fuel. The nutrition issues, the exercise issues, they all go hand in hand. It's a teeter-totter. What you put in compared to what you take out. Both of those go a long way. Practicing what you preach. We do that every day, and I think it's real important to look at that. And also, when you do these things, I can tell you right now, is get ready for an exciting ride. because great things are going to happen. Your attitude is going to be better. Things are going to come a lot more easy. And I think when you're fueling that and you're doing the right things and the right kind of attitude, and suddenly your patients and your people and people in your world see it, is a great thing, and get ready for that. And I want to leave you with one last quote, is the fact that from Charles Darwin, we talked about Darwin and that whole survival mechanism, is he says, survival is not from the strongest and most intelligent species, but those are most responsive to change. Well, you turn around there for sports medicine, and you could say, it's not the strongest sports medicine specialist that survives, nor the most intelligent, but the one that's most responsive to change. So a sports medicine specialist, what's going to be your change? And it's all going to start with your why. Thank you.